tonight before I give the message by sharing with you what I believe the Lord is saying for 2017. The Lord woke me up about 3 o'clock in the morning, October the 2nd, 2016, and He gave me this word, and I wrote it down. And before I go into the message, I just want to give it to you. The scriptural basis is Joshua chapter 1, verse 11, and Joshua 3, verses 14 through 17. There'd been a transfer of leadership. Joshua had now assumed the helm. And the Lord spoke that it was time to make preparation. And here's what the word is that the Lord spoke to me to share with the church for this season. It's crossover time. Amen. Prepare to experience something, a move of God that's never happened before. Amen. Set your house in order. Get yourself ready to experience miracles and the harvest. Behold, I will do something new, saith God. The barrenness is over. Songs of deliverance will be sung. A change in the spiritual atmosphere has occurred. In the barrenness, you have pulled back, and weariness and discouragement tried to cause you to doubt whether the promises that I gave you will ever come to pass on your behalf. But I say to you once again, the barrenness is over. Now it's time for overflow, overflow, overflow. All restrictions are removed. Don't limit me. Don't doubt. Unbelief and false teaching will keep you from receiving your miracle. Accelerated blessings are coming. Start expecting them in a proportion that you have never received before. I will have an end time church where my people will not have church as usual. Amen. My children will hear my voice and have an open heaven because they've been in the secret place of the Most High. Superstars will fade as the bright and morning star will shine brighter and brighter. Awake, my church, revival is in the air. Get into proper position so you can be used in this end time revival. Forget the past, cover it with the blood, and move forward. The wealth of the wicked will be transferred to the righteous. Your next step is a place of abundance. It's a place of overflow. Prepare for it. If you will yield to my holy fire and be purified, the fullness of my glory will operate in a realm that you have never had operate on your behalf. Some will resist my cleansing fire, and they will fall away in these last days. Receive the fire of purging, and you will overcome the flesh, the world, and the devil. The giants that have screamed threats and accusations against you will fall before your faith in action. My word as a seed has been planted into your spirit by your pastors and other capable ministers of the word, and it shall come forth and bear forth fruit in this season. Flow in my spirit. My seasons are for seasoning. The seasons I have brought you are for seasoning. In each season, I've deposited into you what you needed for the next season. Live a separated, pure, holy life. Stay filled with the Spirit of God. Again, I say unto you, it's crossover time. It's time to experience overflow. Receive it. Now, if you receive that, just lift your hands up. Give the Lord honor and glory and praise. Amen. Hallelujah. Say, I believe I receive.
I believe I receive.
In Jesus' name.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Glory to God. Turn with me tonight, if you will, to the book of Colossians chapter 3, verse 1. Colossians chapter 3, beginning with verse 1. When evangelist Billy Graham first started his ministry, he held a crusade in Haringey Arena in London, England. Amen. One day he walked out of his hotel room and there was a young boy standing there, and he looked at the young boy and asked him directions to the local post office. The young boy told Dr. Graham how to go to the post office. Then Dr. Graham looked at the young lad and said, "Son, I'm preaching at the Haringey Arena. I'm preaching every night, and I'm telling people how to get to heaven." And the little boy stood and looked at him for a second and said, "Nah, I don't think so. You can't even find your way to the post office." That's a true story. But tonight, with the power of the Holy Spirit, I want to take you to a place where I've been. And a place where I want to be sure every one of you are ready to go. It's a place the Bible calls heaven. Colossians chapter 3, beginning with verse 1. "If ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affection on things above, not on things on the earth." This is a direct command from God Almighty that we are to set our hearts and minds upon heaven. One of my favorite translations of the Bible simply says, "Keep seeking heaven." The most stupendous thought that can ever occupy the mind of man is heaven and how to get there. And thank God He's not left us to grope in darkness, but He's given us His Word as a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. The human heart longs for the blessed immortal assurance that one day we're going to live with God forever in a place that's free of sickness, disease, poverty, and grief. And I've come tonight with good news. Jesus Christ has been preparing for us such a place, and He's personally promised to return and take us to live with Him there throughout all eternity. Amen. Just prior to His departure from the earth, He gathered all of His disciples into an upper room, and He gave them these comforting words of reassurance. He said in John chapter 14, verse 1, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in Me. In My Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you." The literal Greek interpretation reads, "Doubt not that there's for all of you a place in My Father's house, for I'm going on purpose to prepare it." I want to start tonight with this fact. Death is a certainty. Death is a certainty. Proverbs chapter 23, verse 18 says, "Surely there is a hereafter." Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 17 says, "God has made all things and has set eternity in the hearts of men, and men cannot even fathom all that God has done on their behalf." 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 23 declares, "Man is a spirit, he has a soul, and he lives in a body." The Bible says it's appointed unto man once to die, and after that, the judgment. The Bible teaches, according to Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 7, that one day you're going to die. Outside of the rapture of the church, you will have an appointment with death. Kings and queens, politicians, and those who play sports, the black, the white, the Hispanic, every nationality will one day, outside of Jesus Christ's return to take the church to live with Him throughout all eternity, will experience death. You are an eternal being. You are just one heartbeat away from eternity. The decision you make in this life determines where you're going to spend eternity. That's why it's so important that we heed the words of Jesus in Matthew chapter 16, verse 26, where He said, "What shall it profit a man if he gain the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul?" Many centuries ago, Job said, "If a man dies, shall he live again?" Now, people still want to know the answer to that question. When you die, do you just cease to exist? Is this life all there is to life? Do you just go to sleep after you've lapsed into a state of unconsciousness? Do you go to a place that some call purgatory, where hopefully you'll be prayed out of that place into a better life beyond? Is there a life beyond this life? Is there a real place called heaven? And on the other end of the spectrum, is there an opposite? The Bible says there is. The Bible calls this place hell. Jesus actually talked about hell far more than he talked about heaven. 244 times he put up signposts in the Bible warning not to go there. There's a place of weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth and separation from God for all eternity. Who in the world in their right mind would make such a decision when you can go to the place that I'm going to describe to you? Amen. If you were to stand before Almighty God, and one day each and every one of us will, and you were asked to give an account of your life as to why God should allow you to gain access and entrance into this beautiful place called heaven, what are you going to say? Maybe you'll try to impress him with your education. Listen to me, education without God's in vain. You take a thief that'll steal the hubcap off your car, educate that dude, he'll steal your whole car. If education would have solved life's problems, we'd solved them a long time ago. I was a very outstanding student when I was in high school and college. I was usually outstanding in the hall watching the girls go by. I was a very promising student. I promised my parents every report card I would do better. But education is not the answer to man's dilemma. Perhaps you'll try to impress God with your good, clean, moral living. A man approached me once, flashed his big fraternal ring in my face, almost blinding me with the diamond that was in the center of it, indicating to me that because he belonged to this certain cult and sect up on the earth, a certain lodge, it was automatically going to guarantee him access into heaven one day. I looked at him and I said, "Sir, is your other hand saved?" Morality will keep you out of jail. It takes Jesus to keep you out of hell. Yeah. One of my favorite quotes is, if your religion hasn't changed you, you better change your religion. You can be baptized, you know every fish and frog social security number in the Bayou City and die and go to hell. Water won't wash away dirt without a little soap. So how in the world is it going to wash away your sin? What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. And I confidently know, because of his shed blood and because I put my faith and trust in what was accomplished on the cross when he declared triumphantly, "It is finished." Amen. I have confessed with my mouth. I have believed with my heart. And I am confident that I will spend eternity in this beautiful place called heaven. Amen. The most important decision you will ever make in this lifetime is to settle where you're going to spend eternity. Amen. Because the Bible says, what is your life? You are just a mist. It appears for a little while and then it vanishes away. And so it's my heart's desire that you have received Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior if you have not made that commitment to him. And then that you'll join a good church like this church with good pastors who are going to teach you the uncompromised Word of God and teach you how to live in victory and live a victorious, overcoming life. That's the best decision you could ever make in this life. I was born on March 1st, 1949 in Dallas, Texas, under the name Gary Lynn Dobbins. At a very early age, my parents, both alcoholics, proved they didn't want the responsibility of raising my little sister and I, so they put us on the front steps of a porch of a family by the name of Wood. This family went through the legal process in the state of Texas, the capital being Austin, to adopt us into their family, granting unto us all the rights and privileges of one bearing the family name. I can easily identify with the Apostle Paul. where he said we haven't received the spirit of bondage again to fear in Romans 8:15, but we've received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. The word adoption means being placed as a son to a family with all the rights and privileges of one bearing the family name. The word Abba, Father is very intimate. It means Papa, Papa, or Daddy, Daddy. So in this new environment, my father, in his drunken stupor, would take cigarettes and extinguish them between my legs just to see my response. I still currently bear those marks on my body. My real natural father would be in today's society put in prison for his actions. But it was ignored back in that time. My little sister is adopted along beside me, and we come out of that horrific, horrible atmosphere into a loving, kind family. All of our needs and many of our heart's desires were granted unto us. We were taken on a regular basis to the Hillcrest Southern Baptist Church in Dallas, Texas, where I heard the greatest message mortal ear can ever hear. I've been on national TV. I've done radio programs. And one of the ultimate questions I'm always asked is, tell us the deepest experience. Tell us the most vivid, the most powerful thing you can share as a result of dying and going to heaven. Here it is. If you want to write it down, here it is. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. So in childlike simplicity, I responded, went forward, prayed a simple little prayer, asked Jesus Christ to wash away all my sins with his precious red blood and cover them and opened up my heart and allowed him to come and be my personal savior. I grew up in this loving environment. My little sister and I loved to play church, would sing hymns. I would preach. We got all of our animals born again. And all the neighborhood kids would come over, would tell them about Jesus. And we just had a wonderful time. But because of economic reasons, my family had to move from Dallas, Texas, where I was born, to a town called Farmington, New Mexico. It borders on the four corners of Colorado, Utah, Arizona, and New Mexico. I actually grew up there, helped my father build the city, build what is now known as the Navajo Indian Reservation. I make this statement very humbly, but I make it only to emphasize the tremendous miracle of which I am about to share with you. For 3 years in a row, I won number one in all-state solo competition. With that, I felt the call of God upon my life, that he wanted me to become a full-time gospel singer, and I started making preparation towards that end. I applied to scholarship and attended Wayland Baptist University in Plainview, Texas. The first semester passed. I was coming home. I received a phone call. It was December 23rd, 1966, and my cousin said, hey, we're going to have a reunion, a party over at the house tonight of all of our high school classmates. There'll be no drinking, drugs, nothing like that transpired, but we're just going to have a good, clean, wonderful time, catch up on what everybody's been doing. So my dad let me borrow his Oldsmobile station wagon if I'd take my little sister. They don't make cars like that anymore. It's like a tank. It didn't have seat belts back then, but it's a big machine. And so I drove, and we went over to the party, had a good time. Party broke up probably 10:25, somewhere along there. And snow is falling. Houses are lit up. It's the Christmas season, and there's joy. And we was anticipating opening presents in a couple of days. My little sister had one of the most beautiful, melodious soprano voices I have ever heard in my life. She began to sing Silent Night, Holy Night. And all of a sudden, she just let out a blood-curdling scream. Farmington, New Mexico, at that time, was in the midst of a big oil field boom. And there was a truck illegally parked on the edge of the highway that afternoon or that night. And she saw just a glimpse of it in the headlights. And she screamed to warn me. It was too late. Just like crashing into a brick wall. And that Oldsmobile station wagon, like a tank, just shrunk like an accordion. The turn signal indicator snapped. Its jagged edge crisscrossed my face, cutting it all apart and doing severe damage, which I will show you the results of in x-ray in just a few moments. There was an explosion. My nose was severed from my face, and then I was free of all pain. Dying was simply like just discarding your clothing and removing and laying it aside. I rose above the top of the car. The Bible says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. Angels came and they engulfed me and they carried me and they began to sing. They began to sing, "Worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive glory and power. Wisdom and dominion be given unto thee forever, O Lord. Amen and amen." And I was escorted right up into the very atmosphere and place the Bible describes and calls heaven. I remember being deposited at the bottom of a beautiful grassy hill. The grass is much thicker than this carpet upon which I'm standing. And it looked like diamonds, like dew, were all over the grass. The grass came all the way through my feet. Yet when you would take a step, there was no indentions in the grass. It remained level. The Bible gives us the location of heaven. Job 26:7 says, "He stretched out the north over the empty place and hangeth the earth upon nothing." And that's because nothing could handle substantially the magnitude of this tremendous city. There are 12 gates, which represent there's accessibility from all areas of the world into the city. There are 12 foundations with the names of the 12 apostles inscribed upon them. There are 12 gates of pearl with the names of the 12 tribes of Israel written upon them. I have actually discovered the dimensions just of one of those gates is over 500 miles in width. Many years ago, I was blessed to speak in a full gospel businessmen's convention in Florida. One of the main men who put Neil Armstrong upon the moon came and gave me some information. He said, "Son, we've done some discovery and we've done some calculations." And he said, "We have actually come up with some of the dimensions of this beautiful place the Bible describes and calls heaven. It's actually over 2,280,000 square miles at its base of perimeter. It's 780,000 stories high. And there's enough room to comfortably accommodate 100,000,000 people. Jesus said, in my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. The city is laid out in a perfect cube, which symbolizes the curse of Genesis 3:17 has forever been removed. Heaven is as large as from the most northern part of Maine to the most southern part of Florida and from the Atlantic Ocean to the Rocky Mountains. It's beyond 150 million stars, of only which 2,000 can be seen with the naked eye on any clear night. I remember gracefully, like a dove would float up into the air. I remember going up and beholding and standing down at the bottom of this beautiful, magnificent, green, grassy hill, looking up at this gigantic structure in awe, in amazement. The 12 foundational stones are the 12 stones recorded in Exodus chapter 28, verses 15 through 21, that are the stones that are on the high breastplate of the high priest. And I could tell you what each stone is and what each one represents, but for time's sake, I'll just tell you one. The bottom foundation is jasper. Now, jasper stands in the Bible for the glory of God. It also stands for diamonds. Think about it, ladies. One day you're not going to be wearing a diamond ring or earring or anklet or bracelet. Sweetheart, you're going to be walking on pure, solid diamonds. Hallelujah. And men, here's the kicker. We don't have to foot the bill. Glory to God. Glory. The Bible says heaven is a holy city. Nothing will enter into that city that will defile it. Just think about not having to lock your door at night. Not having to use a gun for protection or mace. Because only the pure in heart are going to be there. There's not going to be any disappointment there, no weariness, no sorrow, no pain. We'll not have to pay taxes any longer. On our mansions will never grow weary. We're never going to be tired. We're going to eat plenty, all that we desire, from the tree of life and the other sources that will be available to us. And glory to God, not gain any calories from it. Hallelujah. There'll be no poverty there. Listen to me. If you got a problem with the prosperity message, come down here and get saved. You're going to be miserable in heaven. There's no hospitals. There's no funerals there. There's no death. There's no crosses on the hillsides of glory. We're going to be perpetually young forever and ever and ever. I remember walking up, and I remember going through one of those magnificent gates, and I remember walking down a corridor, and there I saw my best friend in high school who had died in a previous accident. Which answers in my mind, will you know one another in heaven? Well, absolutely you will. And I saw John. He ran over, he grabbed me, and we hugged one another and exchanged greetings. When you get to heaven, someone is assigned. It may be a loved one, it may be someone that you knew well down here on the earth, but someone, a family member, someone will greet you when you cross over. And they will be there for a specific purpose, and that's to acclimate you to this place called heaven. And my escort was John, my best friend. And after we had discussed a little bit, he said, well, you need to come with me. And he began to take me on the tour. First of all, we went to a library. There he took me, and I saw volumes and volumes and volumes of books. But the most important book that he shared with me was the Lamb's Book of Life. I saw the pure white lamb's wool. And he went over and he flipped the pages till he found my name. And it said next to my name, paid in full by the precious red blood of Jesus. Glory to God. I saw prayer requests. I saw spiritual growth. I saw people that we've won to the Lord recorded in all of these books. The dearest thing to the Father's heart is leading people to Jesus. I actually saw it transpire. I saw a man come down in a service like this. He received Jesus Christ as his personal Lord and Savior. And I saw people in heaven sitting on, all I can describe, it's like bleachers that you would experience at a sporting event. And they were looking down. Now, they're not concerned with what you're wearing, what car you're driving, what kind of house you live in. But they are there to encourage you. This is biblical. It's in the book of Hebrews. There's a great heavenly host up there. And they're looking down. And they're cheering you on. I remember when my late pastor, John Osteen, called me on the phone and said, Gary, you got to get your book into print. Pastor Osteen, some of you may have seen under his ministry, mighty general of the faith, but he'd always say, great it is to dream the dream when you stand in youth by the starry stream. But a greater thing, a greater thing, a greater thing is to fight life through and at the end say the dream came true. Oh, yeah. Well, he encouraged me. And he said, put this in print. And now our book's in six languages. Amen. It's recorded in Russia. It's one of the best sellers in Russia currently, right now, because someone was there encouraging me. Amen. And you all have a loved one, a family member, a friend that's up there, and they're encouraging you to go on and fulfill your assignment. And I saw when this man got born again, some of these people went quickly over to another section of heaven. They found his mother who was in heaven, and they told her that her son had just gotten born again. And oh, what rejoicing there was. Then I saw the angel go over and transfer out of what the Bible calls the books, from the moment you're born to the moment you die outside of Christ, every thought, every deed, every action is recorded in what the Bible calls the books. When you are born again, all that's eradicated. And I saw an angel just wipe it all out, just with a simple little sweep. And then I saw your name written down in the Lamb's Book of Life. If your name's been recorded there and you're sure you're going to heaven, lift your hands up and praise the Lord right now. Come on, give Him glory. Give Him honor and give Him praise. Hallelujah. Then I went to the throne room of God. It's surrounded with a beautiful emerald rainbow. There are what appear to be like a menorah. There are 12 golden lampstands. There are flames of fire shooting out, which represent the precious presence of the Holy Spirit of God. I saw the 24 elders, 12 from the Old Testament, 12 apostles of the New Testament, with crowns upon their heads. They would take the crowns off, they'd cast them down at God's throne, singing, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is and is to come." Flowing directly from the throne room of God was a beautiful crystal river. It would diversify into the 12 different foundations. On the side of the foundations were trees that bore different fruit. When you ate the fruit, it wasn't like any fruit here on the earth. When you ate the fruit, you became the fruit. Now, brother, I said that for a lot of years and discovered that people thought I meant you become fruity. So I had to stop and explain. All of a sudden, unlimited knowledge is what the kids would say, downloaded into you. All of you have questions. They won't be near as important when you get there. But you'll know things that you want to have answered. Why did this happen? What caused that to take place? And so on and so on. But you'll just instantly have all of these answers. And you're going to have all the vast, unlimited knowledge of God made accessible and available to you. I remember seeing people. I remember seeing people from other areas in heaven, clothed in their nationality, their clothing that they wore in their particular country. But what I saw up around where I was in the throne room of God area was people had on three different levels of a robe, and it was transparent, but there was no drawing to male or female body parts. I remember the outer garment was like what the high priest wore. It had all kinds of things that you had accomplished here upon the earth. So you'll just know, for instance, you'll know your pastors were pastors and what they did for the kingdom of God, and singers, you'll just instinctively know that. And then I was led down into this beautiful body of water. It was so refreshing to taste. I remember it had no bottom, but it substantially was able to hold me up. I remember reaching down, picking up golden nuggets bigger than my fist. I remember all kinds of precious jewels floating through my fingers. The light of the city is Jesus. When He shines upon this beautiful creation, there's a diversity of colors and exemplified beyond what I have the vocabulary to declare to you. I remember then being lifted up, standing on the other side of the river. I remember seeing a host of redeemed humanity, and they were all singing, "All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall, bring forth a royal diadem and crown Him. Crown Him, Lord, Lord of all." I said, "John, why are they singing hymn number 132 in the Baptist hymnal in the church that I grew up in?" And he said, "Gary, all songs of the Spirit originate in heaven." He said, then they're dropped down into the heart of somebody who'll be faithful to give that song forth for the glory of God. First time I heard the chorus, Alleluia, was in heaven. First time I heard the little chorus, He is Lord, was in heaven. First time I heard some little choruses that we sing in our circles was in heaven. It'd be many, many years later I'd actually hear them on the earth. So I say to all you musicians, all you singers, you can become pregnant with a song. You can give birth to a song directly from heaven that will give all glory and honor and praise to God. I have a background in music. I'm just telling you what I saw. I saw musical notes floating over the hillsides, and they would just go into a person. Boom, go, and the person just break out in spontaneous song, a new song. I saw trees, and they were clapping and giving glory and honor and praise to God. When the water ran over the precious jewels of diamonds and rocks there in that beautiful river of life, a beautiful musical sound of utterance would come forth. Flowers had faces. And the flowers would sing. I'm not evangelistically speaking. I'm telling you what I saw. The streets were called Hallelujah Boulevard and Praise the Lord Avenue. Everything in heaven worships, magnifies, and praises the Lord. So come on, let's give Him glory. Let's give Him praise. Come on and praise Him. He's worthy, worthy. Glory to God.
Amen.
I saw angels working on what only I could describe, clay. It looked like clay. But it was globs. It looked like just globs of flesh, soft clay. And these angels were molding and fashioning and making something. I observed for a while. I asked my friend, I said, what is it? There's different angels. There are angels that are called seraphims. They're burning ones. They're constantly around the throne of God. There are cherubims, different kind of angels, different wings. But I saw these angels, and these angels were molding and fashioning and forming. And I asked, what is it? And my friend said, it's aborted babies and miscarried children. So if that has happened to you, if you've had an abortion, God will forgive you of that. If you had a miscarriage, rejoice, because I actually saw a mother and her child reunited. But until such time, God is forming, fashioning that child into whom they are destined to be. And you will be reunited with that child and know who they are. I saw these angels carrying golden bowls. From the bowls was flowing a watery substance. I asked my friend, I said, what's that? He said, that's the tears of the saints on the earth below. When you shed a tear, it doesn't absorb into your clothing, go unnoticed. No, an angel grasps it, takes it directly to the throne room of God up on your behalf. Then I saw these golden bowls that contained a substance flowing out of it that looked like, I can only describe it as dry ice. It's billowing and flowing out, that foggy substance look. I asked my friend, I said, what's that? He said, that's the saints on the earth below and in heaven magnifying and praising God. Glory to God. Glory to God. When you shout, when you lift up your hands, when you rejoice like you're doing here tonight, and every time you're gathered together, angels are in the midst of you. Angels are coming. Angels are gathering up all that praise. They're taking it directly. Let's give the angels something to do. Come on and praise Him. Glory! Glory to God! Hallelujah! Glory, glory! I saw children who had died in accidents. Zechariah 8:5 says and declares, the city is one with boys and girls playing in her streets. I saw children rolling down the hillsides of glory. When playing with a lion like you would play with Fluffy or pet cat. People don't know, are the animals in heaven? Well, of course there are animals in heaven.
Yeah. Amen.
God made them in His original creation for us to enjoy, and there's going to be animals for us to enjoy. there in heaven, and I saw magnificent, beautiful horses. I saw birds that would come and light upon the precious children. Such joy, such laughter, rejuvenating, reverberating off the walls and the hillsides of glory that would just energize you. And then I went to one of the most unique things that I saw on my visit to heaven. I walked up with what would be like you would store your personal possessions. And I saw a sign on the outside of the door, and it said, "Unclaimed blessings." I opened the door and saw legs hanging from the wall. I saw arms. I saw every part of one's anatomy there. And you say, "Well, why is there a room like that in heaven?" Because God has a spare part room. God has a miracle for you. Someone says, "Can you substantiate that?" Well, I substantiate everything with the Word, but I can give you one scripture, and it's the last verse in John. Jesus did many miracles. So many miracles he did that all the volumes and books at the time and in the whole world couldn't contain it all. Well, I saw all these miracle spare parts just ready for people to receive and activate. And you say, "Well, that's what I come here for." Not, I need a miracle. I'm just going to simply tell you what I saw. I saw a congregation not this big. I saw people worshiping, praying, and they were asking God to do certain things. And I saw God the Father receive the prayer, speak to Jesus. Jesus dispatched the angels. The angels went over, got the spare parts, came. Sometimes, instantly, the person got the miracle. And they'd throw their hands up and say, "Praise God, I believe I receive." And you'd see that manifestation. Other times, there was demonic warfare. You remember Daniel. But the miracle was released. It was released the moment that Daniel uttered and prayed and made the request. But there was great opposition that took place. And so I saw all that spiritual opposition warfare, which I'll explain to you a little bit deeper here in just a minute. But I witnessed all that. And I would see people start making excuses. And they'd say things like, "Well, I don't have enough faith." Well, listen, sweetheart, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. And they'd start saying, "Well, it just must not be my time to receive a miracle." Let me tell you, it is your time. He's the God of yesterday, today, and forever. The same things that Jesus did on the seashore of Galilee when he walked here upon the earth and opened blind eyes and unstopped deaf ears and caused the lame to leap and shout for joy. That same Jesus in his resurrected power is here tonight to give you a miracle. Amen. You say, "Brother Wood, that's so simple." It is simple.
Amen.
It's so simple. It is simple.
Amen.
People miss it because Pastor John Osteen, this is one of my favorite stories. He's preaching one night and he's talking about miracles, laying hands on the sick, anointing with oil. And this little girl's mother was dying of cancer. And so she went after hearing Pastor Osteen preach, and she went out, looked all over her house for some oil to anoint her mother. She couldn't find any till she got in the garage. There it was. 30 weight motor oil, Haviland, 30 weight motor oil. But seeing her little childlike innocence, she just believed the man of God, oil. And so she climbed up, got that oil, poured it all over her mama from the top of her head to the true story. And the mama got healed. Glory to God. So if you need a miracle tonight, lift your hands up, spiritually, physically, financially. Say, "I believe I receive."
I believe I receive.
Say, "This is my night
to
receive my manifestation.
I
will not be denied.
In Jesus' name.
All for the glory of God." I have a letter from Suzanne Pierce. She lives in Missouri. And she called me one night. And she just said to me that she had to be admitted to the hospital because she thought she was suffering from bronchitis. However, when they ran some tests on her, they discovered that one side of her heart had actually stopped functioning. She was actually only operating on 18% of the heart on the other side. But she didn't really know that at the time. But she just simply asked me to pray. So I prayed a very simple little healing prayer. She says the miracle power of God hit me full force. I fell off the bed. And the doctors rushed in. They said, we've got to do surgery immediately. Put a cath in. And after prayer, she said, please go back and do another test. They went back, came back. And the doctor walked in holding up the picture of the x-ray and declared, lady, if I were you, I would take this, frame it, hang it on my wall, because you got a brand new heart. Glory to God. Come on. I'm telling you. We're going to start seeing those kind of manifestations in 2017. Glory to God. And I went to the mansion I'll spend all eternity in. No two mansions are exactly alike. And I was in other mansions and had all the things people liked and made them happy. But when I went into my mansion, it wasn't ready for occupancy. So I looked around and there were just three buckets of paint. And my friend walked over. There's no furnishings or anything. And my friend walked over, took his hand and flung it against the wall. And a beautiful floral arrangement appeared right before my eyes. Now, if you really got to know me, you just know this is the way I am. I took the whole bucket, flung it up in the air. Whole room was filled with roses, sweetest smell. Then I left, walked down the street that's like this plexiglass pulpit. It's transparent. Scientists have proven there's impurity in gold. And when that impurity is removed, gold becomes crystal clear. So it's just like this with dimensions. And I'm walking down. It's pure, crystal clear, solid gold, transparent gold. Flowers are singing. Trees are waving. And I come and meet Jesus. Jesus, the lover of my soul. The question I'm often asked is, what nationality is Jesus? Jewish. You're not going to lose your ethnicity when you die and go to heaven. Jesus stands a little taller than the average Jewish man. He's about 6'2". There's a little girl that's painted a picture, and I'll say it's very accurate. The only thing is, I saw Jesus with pure, solid white hair in his glory. His eyes were blue. Jews from the house, tribe, lineage of David are known to have blue eyes. I saw where they drove the nails in his hands. I saw where they planted the crown of thorns, buried them down deep into his brow. I saw him with his regal robe of righteousness with a magnificent purple sash that said King of Kings and Lord of Lords, a golden belt girding him. When he spoke, he sounded like Niagara Falls. And he said, heaven is my creation for you. He said, all that you see, I have created it for your enjoyment. I am the center of it all. Amen. He said, I'm sending you back on assignment. Amen. I want you to go back. I want you to tell people there's a song to sing. There's a missionary journey to take. There's a book to write. There's a sermon to proclaim. He said, I want you to tell everyone that they are unique, they're special with me. Amen. God threw away the mode when he made you. He said, tell people don't ever bind to the condemnation of the devil that they're unworthy. He said, tell them they're worthy because I've redeemed them with my precious blood.
Amen.
And then Sid Ross said to me, Gary, you've got to start emphasizing this. So I'm going to emphasize it as simply as I can. This is what Jesus said. I served in the United States Army, and I'm very proud of that. And there's one thing I learned very quickly. When you get into the Army, if you want to survive, listen to the general. Obey the general's commands or your superior officer. Just do what they say to do. And so I'm simply just giving you the instructions that my commander-in-chief said to me. He said, why do my people not believe in me. Not the heathen. So why do my people not believe in me? Why do they reject me? Why don't they walk in my commandments? And then he commissioned me and sent my book, and I'll just tell it real simply. He said there's three things that are going to happen just prior to his return. There's going to be a spirit of restoration that's going to take place. Get ready to get back what the devil has stolen from you. Jesus said, tell my people they do not have a provision problem, they have a revelation problem. Just before Jesus comes back, we're going to begin to learn who we are in Christ Jesus. I'm sure you're doing that. You're part of this great church. And he said, our reaping is going to overtake our sowing. He said, whoo, did you get that? In the last days, he said, there's going to be a release of false doctrines that are going to cause people to operate in wrong motives. He said there's going to be a strong political spirit of manipulation prompted by witchcraft that will seek to control people and lead them into deceit.
Okay.
Hello? Is it important where you go to church?
Yes.
You better believe it's important where you go to church. That's why you need godly pastors like you have. That's why you need to be here hearing the word of God. So that you can be built up and have victory over the world, the flesh and the devil. Jesus told me, I'm seeing this all happen right now. Jesus told me the last spirit that would attack the church is the spirit of Jezebel.
Yes. Amen.
Turn on 6 o'clock news. It's happened every night this week.
Yeah. Amen.
Hello? Okay. We're that generation.
Mm-hmm.
And but we can get ready to get back what the devil has stolen from us.
Amen.
In relationships, you'll get back. If there's been children that have gone away from the Lord, you can get ready to call them back. You can get ready to call back loved ones out of the kingdom of darkness. Bring them back into light. Hallelujah. Number two, Jesus taught me how to pray. He said just prior to his return, there'll be a great emphasis on prayer. My spiritual mama's Billy Brim from Prayer Mountain in the Ozarks. And she has a tremendous prayer ministry. Franklin Graham has a tremendous prayer ministry. Jesus showed me what happens. He said there's demons over cities. They rule and reign over these cities. And he said, if you give access to those spirits, they will come in with swarms of flies and they will multiply and cause great, great division and strife, and all kinds of damage will ensue as a result. But if we pray, and he said, always pray like this, it is written.
Amen.
He said, then you can pray, it is finished. And he showed me when we pray with the power of the word that angels go forth and they burst asunder all of the demonic opposition and loose the heavenlies, and the spirit of revival begins to fall down. I prophesy, just meeting your pastors and being here a few times, I'm telling you, the spirit of revival is upon this church.
Amen.
Get ready. Get ready. This building's way too small. Way too small for what God's just about to do. Then number three, he said there'd be a great emphasis upon miracles.
Amen.
The most important thing in your life is a miracle, especially when you need one.
Amen.
You say, I don't believe in miracles. You will when you need one.
Amen.
Some point, physically, spiritually, financially, you're going to need a miracle in your life.
Yes.
I was just in South Carolina. And I was in a nursing home, and they wanted me to share my testimony. And it was a good thing, because most of the people I was addressing looked like they were just one breath away from eternity. I'm not saying that rude or crude. It's just the fact. And they wheeled a black man in over to my right. And he starts raising his hand like this and waving his hand, and I couldn't ignore him. I said, yes, sir, what is it? How could I help you? He goes, preacher, are there any wheelchairs in heaven? I said, well, no, sir, there aren't. Good, he said. I think I'll get up out of this one and walk. He said, I think I'm just going to do what 1 Peter 2:24 declares. By his stripes, I am healed.
Amen.
And I said, well, sounds good with me. Go for it.
Amen.
And he got up and he started walking. And when he got up and started walking, all of a sudden, all of the nursing staff came in and they started running over to him. And I wouldn't learn till later that actually he was brought into that nursing facility with a stroke where he suffered massive damage. He couldn't speak or move. Notable miracle number one. He's waving to get my attention. Notable miracle number two. He speaks. Hey, preacher, are there any wheelchairs in heaven? Good. I think I'll get up and just get out of this one. And notable miracle number three, he got up and walked. Glory, 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 glory to God. Get ready for miracles like you have never experienced in your entire life. Time is run out, but I'm in the presence of Jesus and I'm receiving all these instructions from him. And all of a sudden, my precious little sister who is in the accident with me begins to cry out, Jesus, 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 Jesus. He's my baby brother. Oh, Jesus. He's my baby brother. David Ingalls wrote a song. It's on the album, I Sure Love You. It's entitled, You Gotta Go Back. She's using that name.
Amen.
And my best friend turned around and said, You Gotta Go Back. She's using that name.
Amen.
All eternity rose back. They noticed life signs. They rushed me to San Juan County Medical Hospital. It has been documented I was dead for 61 minutes. The FBI has legally checked me out because they thought I was a con artist at one time. Just trying to get my... You can't tell this story for 50 years and it not be valid. I mean, they're going to find you out one way. And so they actually documented I was dead. And I went to the hospital. And when I was in the hospital having surgery, and I apologize because it looks like I walked off and forgot that one of the most important things, and that's my x-ray. But we do have a copy, I think, in the book. But when I was there in the hospital, I needed a miracle. I was desperate because my vocal cords were severed. My larynx was crushed. My jaw was broken in three places. My neck was broken in C1, C2, C3. I have showed the x-ray, and people who thought I was a phony have gotten born again just from seeing the x-ray. And Jesus walked in my hospital room when I heard this song, and it simply was, He touched me. Oh, He touched me. And oh, the joy that floods my soul. Something happened, and now I know He touched me and made me whole. And Jesus just walked right in. He just touched me. He just put his hands right on my throat right there. Touched me and just walked out of the hospital room. A little nurse walked in. She's carrying her little tray of food that she had been faithfully taking care of me for the past 9 months. And when she walked in, she goes, Good morning, Mr. Wood. How are you doing this morning? When Jesus comes into your room, everything changes. I threw my hands up and said, Praise God, I've been healed. And she dropped the tray because, see, I couldn't speak.
Hallelujah.
And in reality, it's going to take a little time for some of you to digest it. You'll probably hit it tonight about 12 o'clock. If your spouse sits up and shouts, then you'll know you got it. I still cannot speak. My vocal cords are severed. My larynx is crushed. My neck was broken the same as Christopher Reeves. Every doctor looks at my neck says that I should be a paraplegic. If you have a C2 break, you're paraplegic. And God miraculously, Amen. Through His Son, Jesus Christ, the healer,
Amen.
Touched me. I jumped out of that bed, went running to the elevator, pushed the button. The door opened. The lady said, going up. I said, I've already been. I said, let me tell you about it. And I've been going everywhere telling everybody. Jesus saves. Jesus heals. That he's the same. And he's got a miracle for you. I don't have time. My time's run out. I won't spend it in prayer. But in 1976, Holy Spirit became a real person to me. Within the person of the Holy Spirit lies the anointing. So the more you become intimately acquainted with the third person of the triune Godhead, the more the anointing is released upon your life. As a Baptist, I was taught you got all the Holy Spirit when you got born again. That's Ephesians chapter 1. You have Holy Spirit come in you when you're born again. But Acts chapter 2 talks about a separate experience. Holy Spirit comes upon you. Mm-hmm. And he empowers you. Amen. And he accompanies it with a new language. There's a doctor at Oral Roberts University that has proven through tests that there's a portion of your brain that does not function except when one prays in the Spirit, in tongues. Whenever you pray in tongues, and it has been tested in this portion of your front lobal brain area, it increases healing hormones released into your body 30 to 40%. Therefore, he concludes it's very beneficial for you to pray in tongues. Do you have to pray in tongues to go to heaven? The Bible doesn't teach that. But it's like these shoes I have. The tongue came with it. Tongue's part of the deal. It's included in the whole package. So you just might as well take it all. Like a day. If ye then being evil know how to give good gifts unto your children, how much more, how much more, how much more, how much more shall your heavenly Father give the Holy Ghost? Now I'm going to wrap this all up. How can an 18-year-old boy receive directions from Jesus in heaven 50 years ago and fulfill his assignment? There were no cell phones back there. There's no internet back there in that time. Wasn't a lot of devices. That, how would that ever happen? And yet, my friend, I tell you, 2 weeks ago in my home, a television crew came from Russia, filmed my story that I just told you tonight, that will be played all over 86% of Russia and reach 115 million people. Glory to God. God. Hallelujah. I've been on Sid Roth 3 times. My daughter accompanied me once. I stood on December the 18th last year on Prayer Mountain, spoke to 68 nations.
Glory.
Amen. Amen.
We are the generation that's going to see the return of the Lord.
Amen.
I'm not looking for the undertaker. I'm getting up for the upper taker. And away. There goes the believer. We're going to the marriage supper of the Lamb. And we're going to have a party. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Come on and rejoice just a little bit. Just rejoice. Just rejoice. Hallelujah. I'm going to tell this story and I'm going to pray. It's a true story. Beautiful, beautiful castle in Switzerland. Sits on top of a hillside. There's a gardener who's been working there for 20 years. It's immaculate. Not a weed in sight. And a visitor went by and saw the gardener engaged in conversation. He said, how long have you been working here? He said, 20 years. He said, I've never seen anything so meticulously beautiful in my entire life. This is just overwhelmingly beautiful. He said, could I ask you a question? He says, when does the owner come? In the 20 years you've been here, how often does the owner come to inspect the property, look it over? And the gardener said, oh, he's only been here 4 times. And the tourist said, my, 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 think about that. 4 times in 20 years? You have kept this place so immaculate, you would think he's coming tomorrow. To which the gardener replied, oh, no, sir, no, sir. I expect him to come today. What a day that will be.
Amen.
When my Jesus I shall see, and I look upon his face, the one who saved me by his grace. When he takes me by the hand and leads me to the promised land. Stand with me. What a day, glorious day that will be. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because he first loved me. Oh, let's sing one more time. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. I love Jesus because he first loved me. Well, that's my assignment. I'm a man on a mission to make Jesus real to this generation. And I want to be sure everyone here is ready to go there. If you're here tonight, you'd say, preacher, I don't know for sure. I know there's things in my life that are not right with Heavenly Father. And if Jesus were to return, I'd be ashamed. I know I wouldn't really be prepared for his coming. But I want to be sure. Maybe you'd say, I've never been born again. Maybe your parents brought you up in church, but you know deep down inside, you never really made a commitment. Maybe you've just put a plastic religious face on, but you know all is not well with your soul. Or maybe you've just been slacking off, not really hungering after God and pressing in and desiring all that he has for this great last move of the Spirit of God. And you just say, Brother Wood, that kind of includes me in both of those areas. And I want a fresh renewal tonight. I want to be sure Jesus is Lord in my life. I want to be sure I've been forgiven of my sins. And I want a fresh touch of the Spirit of God. Lift your hand up and say, pray for me. Just lift it up anywhere in the auditorium. Praise God. I see your hands. Yes, yes, yes. I want us all to pray this prayer. Say, oh God.
Oh God.
Without Jesus,
I'd be lost.
Separated from you. For all eternity. I don't want to die and go to hell.
I want to live in heaven.
The Bible says,
whosoever
shall call upon the name of the Lord
shall be saved.
Forgive me of all my sins.
You said in the Word,
if we confess our sins,
he's faithful and just
to forgive us of our sins.
And to cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Thank you, you're writing my name in the Lamb's Book of Life.
You're erasing my sins.
Covering them.
With your precious blood.
I make a commitment tonight.
I'm going to turn
from the world,
the flesh,
and the devil.
I'm going to live for God.
Holy Spirit,
you are welcome in my life.
I receive you as a free gift.
I receive the Holy Spirit
with the evidence
of speaking in other tongues.
I will not be denied.
Thank you for giving me victory.
And I'm going to tell everybody
what you have done in my life
and what you're doing in my life
and help prepare them
to go to a place called heaven.
Now just lift your hands up and say, I believe I receive.
And open your mouth and begin to praise God.
Zevete ke shekete la makata la bo. Govo bo sakata la sihikite kandando.
Come on and praise him. Just give him praise.
Come on and give him glory and honor.
Thank you for joining us for the preaching of God's word. We trust that your faith and your love for God is stronger than ever before. More information about Stevenson Ministries and Houston Faith Church is available online at houstonfaith.tv. Chaz and Joni Stevenson are the pastors of a dynamic, growing church in Houston, Texas, and have a New Testament vision of preaching the uncompromised Word of God with the power of the Holy Spirit, helping people get saved and building strong Christians who can impact their world. Houston Faith Church is a place where the love of God is real, where lives are changed, and where followers of Jesus become fishers of men.